Right, well, welcome to everybody joining us for our service this morning. Let's just open our hearts to the Lord Jesus in prayer. Father, we are reminded where two or three are gathered in your name, you are present with us in a wonderful way. And there's more than three here today. Thank you, Father, for all who've joined on Zoom. And we pray your blessing upon this service from beginning to end. May we be touched by the power of the Holy Spirit this morning. Amen. Now Robin's going to lead us in our sung worship.
Well, it's lovely to be with you all this morning. And I don't know about you, but I've been so encouraged through the Andrew Ollerton book, the last section in it, about the hope that we have. And when I was a child, Mum and Dad encouraged us to learn or memorize scripture. And I wish I'd done more of it. But one passage that I did memorize when I was younger and that often comes back to me and has returned to me over and over this week is the passage at the beginning of 1 Peter. And it just says, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil or fade, kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honour when Jesus Christ is revealed." We're on a wonderful journey, aren't we? Having entered into the kingdom of God through faith in Christ Jesus, and we've entered into this living hope. So we're going to sing that this morning. I'll just share my screen.
Desperate.
Carrying on at verse 8, it says, though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Lord, we thank you for that living hope that you plant in our hearts when we come to faith in you. We thank you, Lord, that the God of ages stepped down from glory to bear our sin. Lord, I thank you for your loving kindness, which you show to us in all the details of our lives. Lord, I thank you that even though we are far apart this morning, Lord, we are together in our heart and our spirit and one in Christ Jesus. Amen. We're going to sing together, Here is Love Vast as the Ocean. And it's a wonderful Welsh hymn. We don't often sing the last verse, but it's really blessed me this week. It just says, in thy truth thou dost direct me, by thy spirit through thy word, and your grace my need is meeting, as I trust in you, my Lord. All thy fullness you are pouring, your great love and power on me, without measure, full and boundless, drawing out my heart to thee. And as we come to later listen to God's word, let's remember that he does speak to us through his word by his Holy Spirit.
Shed.
Thank you, Robin. We're going to come to the Lord Jesus in prayer. And we think of the words that we've been just listening to. Here is love vast as the ocean. I believe that the prayer breakfast yesterday with the Welsh prayer breakfast was a wonderful time. And every time I hear to that song, it makes me think of it. And it makes me think of the boundless wonder of God's love in our hearts today. So shall we come to the Lord Jesus in prayer? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come into your presence. In our hearts, we kneel before you, and in faith, we recognize your glorious holiness as we gaze into the shining light of your goodness, purity, and love. In heaven, God's kingly rule reigns. And may, Lord, your rule reign in the lives of all on earth. We pray for your kingdom to be extended throughout the world, in every village, in every town, in every city, and in everyone. As the Apostle Peter reminds us, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Throughout this period of worldwide pandemic, we pray especially for the needs who are those waiting for operations and treatments. We pray for those who are cared for in their own homes by family and carers. We also pray for all those who are receiving end-of-life care. Draw near to them, their families and friends, and those able to pray with them and gently to point them to the Lord Jesus. We remember in prayer the doctors, nurses, and ancillary workers, the ambulance service, and all working for the NHS, especially those serving in intensive care wards. Grant them rest of mind and body. We pray for all serving in surgeries, care homes, and in home visits. Refresh them, we pray, in their calling. We also remember those who are going into hospital for treatment as day patients. Reassure them in their appointments and grant them great peace in their hearts. We remember especially the Christian Medical Fellowship giving support to national health workers throughout their website and giving spiritual and practical advice and help. We remember them in our prayers. And we thank you, Father, that you promised to provide all of our needs, needs of mind, needs of body, and needs of soul. We ask your forgiveness if we've been selfish rather than selfless. And may we forgive others who have hurt us. We remember the words of Jesus, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." May we be strong when we are tempted. We are reminded by the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 10:13, "No temptation has taken over you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will always provide a way so that you can endure it." We thank you, Lord, for all these things, and we praise you, Father, for your church throughout the land. Encourage all believers to open their hearts in prayer and express their love for Jesus in every way they can. For, Lord, the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. We praise you, Lord, that we are on the winning side. Amen. And now Dan's going to give his testimony.
Not Dan, Tim.
Tim, thanks.
Hi guys, my name's Tim. Many of you know me. And I want to pick up my story when I was the age of 21 years old. I was settled in a marriage that had a beautiful house, had a lovely car, and had a really good job with great career prospects. And I thought that I had everything that I need for a content and happy life. Unfortunately, the unexpected happened, and my marriage came to a crashing divorce, and it was absolutely devastating. And that in my life set off cycles of negative behaviour, which ultimately led me on a path to destruction. But it was in my darkest day, in my lowest moment, that I encountered my Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. It was in that moment that I remembered that there was hope and life in Jesus from things that I'd learnt in my teenage years attending a local Baptist church. My journey of coming to know and walk with the Lord Jesus is less like a once saved and everything's okay thereon, and more like the untangling of chains as I've shaken off that old worldly behaviour, my old self, and put on the new self that is Jesus Christ. I can remember back in 2017 when I walked through the doors of this church, I'd been through a difficult time and I knew that I needed Christian fellowship and unity. I needed to learn how it was to walk alongside the Lord Jesus in the fellowship of the church. And I just felt a strong set move of the Spirit in my heart telling me, this is where I've placed you. And placed I was. It's been a wonderful journey the past couple of years, just growing both me personally and as part of this fellowship. And I so look forward to many more years seeking and serving the Lord together as we look to what he has for us all as the body of Christ in this fellowship. Hope this has blessed you. God bless.
Right, now Tim's going to come into membership in the church today, it's full membership. So I'm going to read these words and ask him to respond to the promises. Just before I say this, it's very interesting. Andrew Ollerton, he served a number of Free Methodist churches in Cornwall. And it was his dad, David, who spoke fluent Welsh and encouraged us, actually, to join in with the Free Methodist Church. So that's just a little bit of history. But now we're going to come to speak, and Tim is going to send his responses. He's going to say them visibly with us. Beloved in the Lord, you've been baptized in Christ and come now to be received in membership in Emmanuel as part of the Free Methodist family. We rejoice with you in all God's mercies that have brought you to this hour, and we join our prayers with yours as you make this sacred undertaking. Do you have the assurance that God has forgiven your sins through faith in Jesus Christ?
I do.
Do you believe the Bible is God's written word, uniquely inspired by the Holy Spirit? And do you accept its authority for what you must believe and how you must live?
I do.
Do you hear resolve, Tim, by God's grace to be Christ-like in heart and life, opening yourself fully to the cleansing and powering ministry of the Holy Spirit, the guidance of the Scriptures, and the nurture and fellowship of the Church?
By God's enabling grace, I do resolve.
Do you accept the articles of religion, the membership covenant, and the goals for Christian conduct and government of the Free Methodist Church, and will you endeavour to live in harmony with them?
Trusting God's power to aid me, I do.
As a follower of Jesus Christ, will you embrace the mission of the Free Methodist Church within and beyond this congregation? And will you join us in giving sacrificially of your time, talents, and resources to help us carry out that mission?
With God's help, I will.
We offer you the right hand of fellowship and welcome you into the Emmanuel, and the Free Methodist family. May you experience may the experience of membership in this body enrich your life and the life of our church. And may your contribution to its life strengthen both you and all of us. Let us pray. And first, before I pray, I was really touched with Tim's testimony. I got to know him really well, but he helped me smash up Robin's kitchen. And we had many conversations. So it's just great to hear how God has been working in your heart and moving on, Tim. So let us come to the Lord in prayer. Father, we rejoice to recognize you as members of Emmanuel Church and the wider Free Methodist family, and bid you welcome into all its privileges. We welcome you into our fellowship and pray that you may be numbered with his people here and with his saints in glory everlasting. May the church be a blessing to you, and may you be a blessing to the church. And now Dan is going to pray.
Father, we thank you for Tim. We thank you for his life and fellowship with us. We pray your abundant blessing on him this day. We thank you for the gifts that you've given him. We thank you for the way in which you're using him in his workplace to serve you. And we pray that you would help him on a daily basis to serve you in that place. Thank you that wherever we are missionaries for Jesus. We're ambassadors for Christ. So empower him and bless him abundantly. And we thank you for his family too, for Chris and for Pauline and for his sister Laura. We pray your blessing on them this day. And we just thank you that you're here with us now. Amen.
And now let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Daniel will lead us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Friends in Christ, I commend to your love and care Tim, whom we this day recognise as a member of Emmanuel Church. Do all in your power to strengthen his faith, confirm his hope, and perfect him in love.
Thank you, Tim. Thank you, Daniel. And now we're going to listen to God's word from Isaiah 42, 1-9, and Jane's going to be reading.
So Isaiah 42, the servant of the Lord. Here is my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom I delight. I will put my spirit on him, and he will bring justice to the nations. He will not shout or cry out or raise his voice in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break, and a smouldering wick he will not snuff out. In faithfulness, he will bring forth justice. He will not falter or be discouraged till he establishes justice on earth. In his teaching, the islands will put their hope. This is what God the Lord says, the creator of the heavens, who stretches them out, who spreads out the earth and with all that springs from it, who gives breath to its people and life to those who walk on it. I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness. I will take hold of your hand. I will keep you and will make you to be a covenant for the people and a light for the Gentiles, to open eyes that are blind, to free captives from prison, and to release from the dungeon those who sit in darkness. I am the Lord. That is my name. I will not yield my glory to another or my praise to idols. See, the former things have taken place, and new things I declare. before they spring into being, I announce them to you.
Thanks, Jane. Wonderful passage of scripture. One of the four, or at least four of them, there are four servant songs in Isaiah. And over the next few weeks, as we run up to Easter, we're going to be having a mini series just delving into some of them. On Wednesday evenings, we'll be looking at some of these things too in our breakout groups. And we're just looking forward to a time of seeking the Lord and being captivated again by Jesus, the servant of the Lord, as we look to him this Easter time. I wonder if you ever decided just to cut your losses. You know, have you ever... You've put so much hope in something and it's just let you down so many times that you thought, right, enough is enough. I'm just going to cut my losses. I'm going to start again. Harry was talking to me this week about a car he's repairing for someone. And he said he's meant to be doing some welding and he took up the carpet. And there is nothing he can weld anything onto because it is so rusty. And he's going to have to say to his client, look, mate, I'm really sorry. You're going to have to cut your losses and move on. Maybe you've been in that situation. Sarah and I sometimes, we cook meals for the family. Have you ever had that moment where you slip with the salt or you leave it and it catches and it just turns out an absolute disaster and you all sit down to eat and you try and grin and bear it and like, yeah, kids, come on, it's fine. And you just get to the point where you're like, this is disgusting. We cannot eat this. Let's cut our losses and go to Mackey's. Our kids love it when that happens. They absolutely love it. Thankfully, it doesn't happen very often. Sometimes we're wise to cut our losses. If we've got a phone contract or an internet contract or a mortgage provider that isn't really cutting it for us anymore, it's wise, isn't it, to go on comparethemarket.com, cut our losses and switch supplier. But what if the thing we've put our hope in, what if the thing we've relied on, the thing that hasn't delivered, isn't a mortgage provider, it isn't our phone contract, it's not our car, but we actually think it's God? Do we cut our losses then? Do we look for our hope elsewhere then? Is there somewhere else that we can look when we feel like our hope has been broken and lost? When we've prayed for stuff and it seems like God hasn't delivered, when we've, all of us have been going through this very awful time, haven't we? Some of us have been really struggling with big illness. Some of us have been dealing with depression and mental health issues as we've kind of been locked in our own homes. Others of us have been stressed by looking after children and the pressures of that, or maybe the worries about work, and or maybe just that feeling of loneliness. Where is God in the middle of that? Where can we put our hope? Do we cut our losses and move on? Or can we put our hope in him? God's people in the time of Isaiah were asking that same question. Should we cut our losses? They were just about to enter into exile. Isaiah 1 to 39, God has been calling them time and time again through the prophet Isaiah. Repent, return to me, or judgment will come. Isaiah warns judgment will come for Israel. It will come for the nations. But in spite of that judgment, God will also offer them hope. And so we get to chapter 39, and Hezekiah's stupidity really seals the deal. He shows the Babylonians around all the glory and all the gold and all the spices and all the storehouses. And as a result, their fate is sealed. They've rebelled against God. They're going into exile. And although Hezekiah will be spared that, 100 years later, God's people end up in Babylon. And they end up in this kind of a lockdown like no other. They're away from their home, from their family, from their friends. They're not able to worship in the way that they would long to because their whole temple has been destroyed. This is a lockdown far worse than anything we're experiencing right now. So that's where they were in chapter 39. But then in chapter 40, it's like Isaiah is suddenly time travels 200 years in the future. And he's speaking into this time after the exile, where God will bring this renewed hope, not just for Israel, but for the whole world. It's that time we were thinking about in the time of Nehemiah. If you remember a little while ago when we were back in the church, when the walls are beginning to be rebuilt, that's the time Isaiah 40 begins to speak into. The problem is God's people don't really trust God still. They are so fed up with being in lockdown. They're so fed up with the fact the temple's destroyed. They're asking all kinds of questions. They're sending all kinds of accusations to God. Things like, God, do you really care about us? God, do you really have the power to do something about this mess, because it seems like you've been sleeping all this time. God, is there really a reason why we should put our hope in you? Or should we look elsewhere for our hope? And so what we get in chapters 41 to 47 of Isaiah is we get this kind of trial scene where God puts himself on trial and he answers their accusations and he says, okay, this is what you're saying about me. Let's just take it one point at a time and see if that's actually true. And he says to them, look, I've never neglected you. The fact you went into Babylon was not me abandoning you. It was judgment for your sin, for your rebellion. I handed you over to your heart's desire. And look, the fact that you're now able to return is because I raised up Cyrus. Remember Cyrus, the king that enabled them to rebuild the temple? God says, I raised up Cyrus to help you and provided him for you. I've acted in history to save you and to rescue you. And then God challenges the gods of the other nations. And he says, okay, then. This is what I've done. I was able to predict the future. I was able to show you what would happen. I raised up Cyrus. What did the Gentile gods do? Just remind me, what were they doing while all this was happening? Were they able to see what happened around the corner? Were they able to predict what was going to happen? Did they offer any hope? These idols that people had to make with their own hands, that they had to nail down to stop them from toppling over, were they able to help? And I love this verse in verse 23 of chapter 41. If you can find it, come with me there. He says to the gods, do something, whether good or bad, so we will be dismayed and filled with fear. He's basically saying, just do anything, you false gods, to prove that you're there. And then maybe you'll offer hope for my people. And of course, the gods do absolutely nothing. And we get this conclusion in the end of chapter 41, going into that verse that we've just read in chapter 42, where God uses the same word three times. If you've got an ESV, you'll have noticed this already. If you've got an NIV, the translation changes the words, but in the Greek, it's the same word three times. Firstly, in verse 24, God says, behold, you're less than nothing. He's talking to the idols. Behold, you are less than nothing, and your works are utterly worthless. And then in verse 29, he uses that same word again. Behold, these idols, they're all false. Their deeds amount to nothing. Their images are but wind and confusion. He's telling them all these idols, all these gods that you might be tempted to put your hope in, that all the Gentiles are believing in, they cannot offer you true hope. You're doubting me. You're wanting to cut your losses, but what does anyone else have to offer? There is no true hope there. And under this morning, for some of us, when we're wrestling with all these things, do we try and put our hope in things that are not God? Do we try and put our hope elsewhere? Do we think, you know, if only our politicians had acted differently, then stuff would be better? If only our politicians had done something different, or the vaccine had got out quicker, or if only I could see my family again, then I'd be happy, then I'd be content, then I'd have hope again. If only the grandkids could come round, if only I could give someone a hug, then I'd be out of this pit. If only I knew what was round the corner in terms of the financial instability of this situation, then I would have real hope. And we kind of put our hope in these things that are good things, but they cannot offer us real lasting hope. They cannot give us hope for the future, because that hope can only be found in God. And that's what God says in chapter 42, verse 1. He said, behold, the idols are less than nothing. Behold, the idols are all false. And the beginning of chapter 42, verse 1, he says, behold, my servant. In comparison to all these false gods, all these false idols that can offer you a kind of quasi hope, here is one who offers you real, lasting hope on which you can depend. And the whole atmosphere changes, and we get the first of these wonderful servant songs about how God will bring lasting hope, not just for Israel, but actually for the whole of the world. God will achieve his plan. So the question they're all thinking as they read this passage, the question that we're thinking is, so who's the servant? Who is the servant in the servant's songs? And if you're Israel reading this, you're thinking, the servant's us. The servant's us, isn't it? After all, in chapter 41, verse 8, it says, but you, Israel, my servant, you descendants of Abraham, my friend. God has been calling them his servant. So they read this and think, yeah, we're the servant. We're the servant. And how often do we do the same thing? Do we think, I can be the answer to my own problem? If I just think better thoughts, if I have a better attitude, if I kind of try and work myself up into a frenzy with this kind of enthusiasm or have more an optimistic outlook, if I grab a self-help book and try and learn some techniques that will enable me to live a better, more fruitful life, then I will have hope. Then I'll drag myself out of this pit. Then I'll be able to see a better future. And that might work for a little while, but it cannot give us lasting hope in the long run. Maybe that's why some of us have been struggling more with this lockdown, I think, than any other, because we're out of resources, aren't we? We are fed up of trying to be optimistic. We're fed up of trying to make plans and them all being changed. We're fed up of not being able to do what we plan to do. Or just of being, we've got that frustration that we can't see our family or our friends. We're like, when is this going to be over? Our resources are at an end. When we look to ourselves, we cannot produce this kind of hope. And it's really clear that Israel cannot be the servant of the Lord. But for starters, it's talking about an individual, one who will come from Israel. But also in chapter 42, verse 19, God says this, "Hear you deaf, look you blind and see, who is blind but my servant and deaf like the messenger I send?" God is saying, Israel, when you're the servant, you're blind. You're deaf. You can't really see me. And by the time we get to chapter 48, what are Israel doing? They're still in rebellion against God. They're still not trusting him. They're still not putting their hope in him. Their hearts are just not in it. They need some change to bring about that kind of lasting hope that they desire. Israel's not the servant. So that they're left asking, who's the servant? And of course, we know the answer. Kids, if you're watching, I'm sure you're screaming at the Zoom screen now. It's Jesus! It's the Sunday school, the classic Sunday school answer, isn't it? But that's the truth of who this servant points forward to. They didn't know his name was Jesus. They didn't know the full revelation of who this servant would be, but they knew that God was promising a rescuer, one who would be chosen by God, a Messiah who would bring this lasting hope. And we know 800 years later, that rescuer comes in the person of Jesus, the baby born in Bethlehem, the one who's the Son of Man, who is called not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. So how does Jesus fulfill this servant song? Well, verse one says, "Here's my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom I delight. I will put my spirit on him and he will bring justice to the nations." And instantly we recognize those words from the baptism of Jesus, don't we? Where God the Father speaks from heaven and says, "This is my son with whom I'm well pleased. This is the one who shares the eternal delight of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. This is the one on whom the Spirit dwells." At the beginning of Jesus' ministry, the Spirit descends on him like a dove and empowers him to spread this justice, the truth about the kingdom of God, his kingdom reign to the ends of the earth. And in Matthew 12, 17, he actually quotes the whole of this servant song. Check it out after we've left this meeting this morning. Matthew 12, 17, he says, "This was spoken to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet Isaiah." It was fulfilled at Jesus' baptism. But we also see in verse 6, he says, "I will keep you and make you to be a covenant for the people and a light for the Gentiles." We think of that moment around the Last Supper in Luke 22, verse 20, where Jesus says, "This blood is a new covenant in my blood." He will go to the cross. He'll make it possible for God's people to share in that new covenant. He will, as it says in verse 9, do a new thing. He'll fulfill the promises throughout the prophets that their stony hearts will be made as flesh. They'll be able to really respond to God. They'll be able to keep the law because God will do this work by his Spirit in their hearts. So he's a covenant for the people, but he's also the light for the Gentiles. Some of the first words spoken about Jesus, as Simeon sees the baby in Luke chapter 2, what does he say? "This is the light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of my people Israel. Jesus is the covenant for the people. He's the light for the Gentiles. He's the one in verse 7 who opens blind eyes, who frees captives from prison, who releases from the dungeon those who sit in darkness. And we're remembering, aren't we, that moment when Jesus marches into the synagogue on that day at the beginning of his ministry, and he reads the reading for the day, Isaiah 61, talking about lots of these very same things. And he stands up and declares who he is, and he sits down and he just says, today, this has all been fulfilled in your hearing. Jesus is the servant who's come to make blind Israel see. Jesus is the servant who's come to free the Gentiles from their captivity to all those false idols we were just thinking about, those ideologies that have got a grip on their heart and on their soul. And Jesus is the servant who's come to release all of us from the dungeon of our sin and our shame and our guilt that we would rot in if it was not for the grace of God. Jesus comes to release us from our captivity to sin so that we can really love God, love his people, be forgiven, live free lives where we belong to his family. And he did that through his death and through his resurrection, as we'll think about in future weeks. And I wonder this morning whether you're watching on Zoom now, whether you've joined us this morning, or whether you're watching later on, do you know that freedom? Have you experienced that release from the dungeon that Jesus promises? Because if you haven't, you can. You can be released from whatever dungeon of shame or guilt or wrongdoing of sin. Whatever you've done, however you feel, however distant or lost you feel, you can be released by Jesus and brought into this family of love that he longs for you to belong to. Will you accept that offer of release from the dungeon of your sin this morning by turning from your sin and putting your trust in Jesus? We've seen who the servant is. We've seen how Jesus fulfills the servant's mission. But what does this song teach us about the kind of servant, the kind of saviour that he is? Well, verse 2 shows what he won't do. He won't do some very important things. They've seen conquerors, haven't they? They've seen Nebuchadnezzar. They've seen Cyrus. They've seen conquerors who dominate, who shout their mouths off, who like to ride roughshod over people. And we've all seen the same, haven't we? We've seen so many of our leaders do the same. They tend to shout their mouths off. They tend to try and ride roughshod over people, shoot people down. Often they're the aspects that we look for in the people that we elect or in our leaders. And this servant won't do that. It says in verse 2, he won't shout or cry out or raise his voice in the streets. Doesn't mean he won't confront evil. He'll do that throughout his ministry, but he'll do it in a way that is humble and lowly in heart, in a way that has his gentle strength, that doesn't seek his own benefit or his own advantage, but always chooses to make himself nothing. You know, if you put your trust in Jesus, he'll never ride roughshod over you. He will never bully you. He will never try and twist your arm or manipulate you into doing something. In his love, he will woo you. He will change you. He will help you. He will enable you. He stoops to serve each and every one of us. And then in verse 3, we see about what else this servant won't do. We do our best, don't we, to help those who are struggling, to help those who are in the pit. Maybe you're looking after people at home, you're caring for them, or you're in a job that requires caring for people who are very vulnerable. And maybe you've just got friends that are going through a really rough patch. Maybe you're one of those people. And we all know that at some point, as much as we want to be kind and generous and loving, all of us get to that point where we just think, not again, not again. What can I do now? How can I possibly help them now? Or we get that way with ourselves. No, why am I in this place again? I'm worth nothing. What can I possibly do to get myself out of it? There's no use for me anymore. That's the way we feel. And we end up sometimes cutting our losses with people, walking out, moving on. If they won't let me help them, I won't help anymore. I believe God will say to us this morning, Jesus will never do that. He will never cut his losses. Look what he does with those who are bruised and those who are smouldering, about to die out. It says, a bruised reed he will not break, and a smouldering wick he will not snuff out. Jesus will never cut his losses and move on. I wonder, how are you feeling bruised this morning? Lockdown's been a bruising experience for all of us, hasn't it? Maybe you're wrestling with something. Maybe you're nurturing a deep hurt or a grudge or something that is just bruising you. And you think, is Jesus just going to walk out on me? Have I been through this dry patch for so long now that means that's it? Is this stress of looking after kids and family life, or this loneliness I feel, is this all I've got to hope for now? Has God just kind of cut me off because I can't G myself up enough? Jesus will never cut his losses. If that's how you're feeling this morning, know that he will lovingly and tenderly, he will restore the bruised reeds. And when we feel like our flame of faith is flickering out, do you know what he does? He breathes and he fans into flame our love for him again. And he wants to refill us with the oil of his spirit so that we can really blaze for him. All of us are having down days. All of us are having difficult days, challenges of different sorts. Jesus won't cut his losses. He is so invested in you. He loves you so much that he lovingly restores bruised reeds and fans into flame flickering candles so that they can burn brightly for him. You know those words, bruised and smouldering? They're the same words as falter and discouraged, just ever slightly different in verse 4. And it's like God is saying, you all falter and get discouraged. You all are bruised and smouldering, but my servant never is. My servant will never falter and get discouraged. You have down days. You have difficult days. You feel like giving up. Jesus will never falter or get discouraged. He'll never stop picking you up. He'll never stop trying to restore you. He'll never stop reaching out with the oil of his love until that day when justice is established on earth, when his kingdom comes on earth as it is in heaven, the new heaven and the new earth. With a God like that, with a hope like that, where else could we go? With a hope like that, that always stoops to service, that never cuts his losses, why would we ever want to cut ours? All we can do is, like Peter says, when other people are abandoning Jesus, and Jesus says, are you going to go too, Peter? And Peter says, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. Where do we look for hope when all hope is lost? Do we cut our losses? No, we come to the one who will never cut his losses, who loves us so much that he gave his all to restore us, to rescue us, and to redeem us, and who gently and lovingly walks with us and serves us through every struggle that we face. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it always speaks to our heart. And Lord, I pray for all of us this morning. We're at different stages of wrestling with doubt and despair. Maybe some of us are on top of the world and we think, I'm absolutely fine, but we know people who are in this situation. And Holy Spirit, we pray that in this moment now, you would come to meet us where we are, that we would recognize again the love of Jesus for us, that you never give up on us, that you never think we're useless, that you never just get frustrated and want to throw us out. No matter how many times we fail you, no matter how much we struggle, you always come to restore the bruised reed. And I pray for anyone who's feeling like that this morning, that you would lovingly pick them up and hold them in the palm of your hand, and that you would fill each of us afresh with your spirit this morning, so that we can blaze and shine this light for you until, as verse 4 says, all the islands, all the coastlands put their hope in you. Amen. We're going to sing a song together. We're going to watch a song as we finish. And after the servant song, each time, what happens is it's like the whole creation just suddenly bursts into praise. And that's our response, isn't it? Jesus meets us where we are. And our response is just to go, wow, what a kind, beautiful, wonderful Saviour do we have. And to encourage the whole of creation from east to west to join in with that celebration. So I'm going to play a song. It's a new song that we don't know, but let the words stir your heart this morning to praise and adore this kind of leader, this kind of Saviour, this kind of hope that we have that never, ever gives up on us. And then after this, John, if you'd like to close in prayer.
We'd like to invite you, wherever you are around the world, to raise your voice and get in on singing together Psalm 150. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
You made the starry host, you traced the mountain peaks, you paint the evening skies with wonders. The earth, it is your throne, from desert to the sea, all nature testifies your splendor.
Father, we thank you for this time together this morning, for Robin, Jane and Dan as they led us in worship, for Tim's testimony. If anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. We do thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for Jane and the reading of Scripture. And we thank you for Dan bringing to us the wonder of Jesus, the servant King. Lord Jesus, we are blessed. And we thank you for the opportunity of closing in praise and entering into the glory of God and the wonder of all that He is. We praise you, Father. Thank you for all that it means to belong and to follow Jesus, the servant king. O Lord, we praise you, and we trust ourselves to you throughout this week, and we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.